Welcome to La Excellence. In this PIB video analysis, we'll supplement your current affairs preparation with the news that is given in the PIB. We'll analyze the issues both from the prelims and mains perspective. Now let's get into the topics. First one is regarding MSMEs and its role in the employment. First, let us identify this is from which paper. This is from our GS paper 3 of mains. This topic can be identified as our topic for employment or topic of industry, because if it is MSME only, then we identify or classify it as part of industry. If we link the employment generation with the MSMEs, then we classify it as employment chapter. This is fine. Then why this was in news? This was in news because of the International MSME Conclave of 2018. Because of this was in news. The importance of this topic is to know the basics of MSMEs, to know the significance of MSMEs. Here, we need to define what is MSME. For defining, we have this act, Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises Act of 2006. Under this act, MSMEs are classified into two types. One is manufacturing MSME, two is service sector MSME. The enterprises are divided into these two types. Again, in the manufacturing MSME, based on the investment, they are divided into micro, small and medium. Here, if we observe this table, in the manufacturing sector, based on the investment in plant and machinery, the enterprises are divided into micro, small and medium. Here, for micro enterprises, the investment in the plant and machinery should not exceed 25 lakh rupees. For the small industry, the investment is between 25 lakh to the 5 crore rupees. For the medium industries, the investment is greater than the 5 crores and less than 10 crore rupees. The industries above 10 crore, they are not classified as MSMEs, they are classified as heavy industry under the manufacturing sector. At the same time, in the service sector, the enterprises are divided based on the investment in equipment. Here, micro enterprises are those enterprises where the investment does not exceed 10 lakh rupees. Small enterprises are those where the minimum limit is 10 lakh rupees, maximum limit is 2 crore rupees. Medium enterprises are those where the minimum is 2 crore rupees, maximum is 5 crore rupees. These are the classifications. But recently, one thing was in news. It is that they want to remove these two classifications and bringing the classification of MSMEs based on the working capital. Working capital is the cost of raw material and the running of the organization in the short term. For that, this cost is called working capital. Based on the working capital, the government want to classify the MSMEs. That we'll see as a separate topic. But as of now, MSMEs are defined as two types under the MSME Act of 2006. Now, the very important thing that we need to discuss here is the significance of MSMEs. Significance of MSMEs need to be studied both from the prelims and mains perspective. Here, I have listed down this as significance. Let's see each one. Inclusive growth. How MSMEs brings in inclusive growth? This can be asked as a prelims bit or as a mains question. It brings in inclusive growth because MSMEs provide employment for the low-skilled and semi-skilled labor. Low-skilled and semi-skilled labor in the manufacturing sector as well as in the service sector. In these two sectors, MSMEs provide employment. It brings in the inclusivity among the people in the society. Second dimension for this is regional development. MSMEs, they need raw material which is sourced from the local areas. So the industries or the enterprises are located in that particular area. Because of that, that entire region gets developed. For example, if we take traditional textile industry. Traditional textile industry in India has lot of diversity. In that, the industries are located all over India. Because of that, what happens? The entire region gets developed, regional development. So regional disparities goes away. Because of these two factors, we call MSMEs as force behind the inclusive growth. Plus, they brings in the employment to the women. Women, because MSMEs employ or work mostly in the unorganized sector. In the unorganized sector, more than 50% are women. So here, women participation will be higher. So women empowerment or women inclusion in the workforce is done through the MSMEs. Because of that, MSMEs brings in inclusive growth. Next is export contribution. MSMEs contribute to 40% of India's overall exports. Because of this, they have huge export potential. Export potential in case of footwear, textile, traditional handicrafts, etc. All these are from MSMEs. Because of that, they have huge export contribution. Not just that, if MNCs, multinational companies want some ancillary material, who provides that? MSMEs provides that. So even the exports of MNCs are propelled by the MSMEs that are locally based. Next is reduced carbon footprint. What is this? We generally study this in our economy, but why did we include this? Here we need to know this concept of localization or factors for the industrial location that we study under geography GS1 in our mains. There we study factors for localization of industries. MSMEs mostly source the materials from the locals or in the same area, and these industries are mostly located near to the market. So market reachability is one of the features of MSMEs, because of which the transportation costs reduce hugely. Because of that, the CO2 emissions reduce. Because of that, carbon footprint reduces. This is also one point that was discussed in the recent international MSME conclave. That's why I have included this point. Next comes employment generation. MSMEs have huge employment elasticity. Employment elasticity is higher for the MSMEs because they source the labor from the semi and unskilled labor in most cases. Because of that, they have huge employment potential. Because of all these factors, MSMEs are very important. But if we observe their contribution to our GDP, it is less. And most of the MSMEs, they operate as unorganized industry. To address these problems, why unorganized industry has problems? Because it doesn't have the credit facilities. The regulation will be stringent. The employment elasticity for the MSMEs is very huge. Because of these, MSMEs play very important role in the economy. But MSMEs face huge problems because MSMEs mostly operate in the unorganized sector. Unorganized sector, because of which they have problems of credit availability, lack of credit availability. They don't have social security. Because of all these things, MSMEs and the growth of MSMEs is not that as compared to the other developing countries. For example, China, it has higher MSME growth rate compared to India. Even US has higher MSME growth rate compared to India. To address these, recently in the last 2 years, many steps were taken by the government. Among them, Make in India, Zero Effect, Zero Defect Scheme, Zero Effect, Zero Defect, Mudra Yojana, to provide small loans for this small sector. In the MSME, we have small, medium and micro. In the micro sector, for micro units, Mudra Yojana was launched to provide affordable credit. Because of all these things, MSME sector is envisaged to grow and contribute much more to the Indian economy and Indian socio-economic landscape. Likewise, if they ask any question in our mains, we write regarding MSMEs, their contribution, problems and solutions. This can be our framework for the mains answer. For prelims, they can ask 40% is the export potential, 49% is the employment generation potential of MSMEs. Like that, this can be asked in both ways. Next is Smart Cities Mission. This was in news because the government has given a report, it has submitted the successful models of Smart Cities Mission. The successful models of different areas. This can be identified as part of our GS2, where we go for development model, or this can be adopted as part of our GS1, where we study urbanization and related challenges. In these two papers, we can include this. Here, the news is different. I'll discuss the basics related to this. Smart Cities Mission. Smart Cities Mission is devised to address the problems of urbanization, unplanned growth and development, lack of infrastructure, unplanned or ineffective governance structure. All these are problems in the urban areas. To address these problems, Smart Cities Mission was launched, and this scheme or this mission is implemented by the Ministry of Housing and Urbanization. Under this mission, 100 cities are selected based on a criteria, and these cities were provided with the finances, 100 crore rupees per year for the 5 years. These funds were provided to develop the city based off different aspects. This selection is based on the city challenge competition, different parameters, the cities were selected, and for these cities the support is given. What are the approaches? This can be our prelims question. What is the approach that we follow under the Smart Cities Mission? We follow area-based approach. Why? What is the meaning of area-based approach? The area-based approach is, for example, if we take a city like Hyderabad, then under Smart Cities Mission, first a plan for one particular area will be taken. For example, let's take Old City. Why area-based development? Because the needs are different. Earlier, we had uniform planning. But the area, for example, if we take Old City, the development need for that place is different from the development need, take high-tech city, development need of that particular area. So area-based planning will be given. Once that area gets developed, another area will be taken that gets developed. Then another area, like that, all the areas in the city, they get included in this plan process and developed based on the area-based approach. In this, government is not just the sole developer. PPP approach is followed for the development of infrastructure, for the development of basic amenities. Private participation, public-private partnership model is chosen under the Smart Cities Mission. Here, why I have given this background is, this is important for our prelims examination. They may give as option 1, this is financed by Ministry of Finance, then that option will be wrong. So we need to remember which ministry implements it, what is the selection process, what are the approaches that are taken up under the scheme. Likewise, we need to remember for all the schemes that are there in the news. Now let's see salient features. This may not be that important for our exam perspective. Salient features I have discussed already. In salient features, the most important thing is area-based development. In that area-based development, these salient features like mixed land use, promotion of walkable areas, promotion of sustainable development, all these are part of Smart City Mission. But we need to remember these. The earlier mentioned funding, selection approaches, those are very important, not this. Now, let's see why the Smart Cities mission was in news. Here, it was in news because Diu, Daman and Diu is Union Territory. In that, this is one island. Diu, Smart City, becomes the first Smart City to run on 100% renewable energy during daytime. They have adopted two strategies. In this renewable energy, they are running it with solar energy. They have adopted two strategies to run it 100% on solar energy. First is solar park. Under national solar mission, solar parks are envisaged. A huge land area is selected. Solar panels are arranged. And solar energy is produced, stored and supplied to the city. That is one approach they have followed. Second approach is they have went for solar rooftop panels. In that, for government, institutions and buildings, they have given support. For the citizens or residents, they have given subsidies. Subsidies to establish rooftop panels. Because of that, most of the residents, they went for rooftop panels. Then they started producing the solar energy. Because of these two strategies, Diu became the first smart city to become 100% renewable energy run Union Territory. Here, prelims question can be asked. Recently, which of the following city became 100% renewable energy during daytime? Then they give options 1, 2, A, B, C, D. Recently in prelims, they started asking factual questions. This may be one of the questions. Diu is the answer. Next, another example that was there in the news is a prototype being tested in Bangalore Smart City. Bangalore is one of the smart cities. In that Bangalore Smart City, intelligent traffic management solution was tested. It is nothing but a software which recognizes where the congestion is there on roads. Then they can advise the traffic to move in particular direction. This is one of the testing models. The other example that they have given is night bazaars in the Jaipur Smart City. See, these three individually, they are not important. Anyways, we don't get a question based on directly these aspects, Bangalore and Jaipur. Mains questions they won't ask, but in our answers, we try to use them. I have given these three because we need to use them as an examples in our answers. For example, if we write smart cities or something, some question related to urbanization and its related problems, there we can use this as solutions or role models, case studies. For that, I have given these. The next issue that is there in the news is regarding e-way bill system. First, let us identify from which part of our syllabus this can be added. This as part of our GS3. In GS3, we have taxation system. Under taxation system, we have direct taxes, indirect taxes. Now, for indirect taxes, we have GST. Under GST, as complement to this, we have e-way bill system. First, we need to know what is e-way bill and what are its advantages, what are its challenges, etc. E-way bill is introduced in complement to the GST. Before e-way bill, what was the situation? Let's see few facts for which we introduced e-way bill. It means what are the problems that were there to introduce this e-way bill system. The problems include logistic performance. The problems can be understood by these two facts. Logistic performance index. LPI is Logistics Performance Index. This index is released by World Bank. This can be asked as a question in our prelims. According to this Logistic Performance Index, logistics cost us 14% of total value of the goods. So, we need to reduce the logistic cost. The time for movement of goods need to be reduced. For that, we need to reduce the number of checkposts. We need to reduce the delays over there. For that purpose, we introduced e-way bill. The other fact is, The Ministry of Road and Transport tells us that typical truck in India spends 20% of time at the check post. In some of the states, this time is more than 20%. Because of these two, what is happening? The logistic transportation cost is increasing, because of which the goods are becoming costlier comparatively. To reduce these costs, to save the time, under GST, many taxes are consolidated and made as one single goods and services tax. Along with that, e-way bill system is introduced. This is nothing but a permit, an online or digital permit given to the logistics. Logistics means, for example, a truck is traveling from place A to B. Earlier, there used to be many checkposts here, but now checkpost numbers are reduced. Even if they are there, they need not take permit every time at every place. They can just show that single message that they get or they can show the e-way bill number. That's it. Because of this, the time of transportation reduces. Now let's see this through this. Here, it's how is it generated? A supplier or a recipient or a transporter of that particular good. It's not just the receiver, it's not just the supplier, it's not just the transporter. Any of these three can generate e-way bill. They can show it at the check post. Then SMS based facility is available. This is fine. There are exemptions. If the value of the goods is below 50,000, then e-way bill is not required. Then these are the exceptions. If the goods are transported from the international port to the ancillary port, then this is not required. This bill is required both at the intrastate, it means within the state, interstate, among the states, or between the states. For these two transportations, this e-way bill is required, but it is exempted if the value of the goods is less than 50,000, if it is in this condition, or if there is any specific agreement between some areas of center and state. Because of this, it reduces. So here I have mentioned entire time of journey reduces. The online reporting makes the system transparent, because of which the corruption reduces. All these are advantages of e-way bill. For our prelims perspective, this is very important. This year they may ask one question out of this. We need to remember both these points. How this e-way bill is generated and what are the exemptions for the bill. Next topic is electoral bond scheme. What is this? Before knowing what is electoral bond scheme, let us identify this news comes under which paper. This comes under our GS paper 2. In GS paper 2, we have Representation of People's Act, under which we study electoral funding. In electoral funding, we have this topic called transparency in the electoral funding. There are different models suggested by different committees. Here, electoral bond is one such scheme that was announced during the 2017 budget. After that, it was notified by the government. Now, we have the third level or third time this electoral bond scheme was launched or announced by an authorized bank. Let us see the details later. But this particular concept is very important for both our prelims and mains. In prelims, they ask what is the scheme and provisions of this scheme. What is electoral bond? Are there any exceptions or not? What is the limit in the electoral bond? That can be asked for our prelims. With respect to mains, they ask regarding this broad concept of electoral funding. Can electoral bonds reduce the lack of transparency in the electoral funding? That can be one question that we can expect in the mains. Now, let us see the details of electoral bond scheme. It is kind of promissory note given by one person to a political party. Political parties are of two types. Election Commission recognizes political parties. With Election Commission, there are registered parties. Only these registered parties which won at least 1% of electoral seats or electoral votes in the Lok Sabha state assembly, they are only eligible for these electoral bond scheme. Now, this electoral bond scheme is nothing but a bond or a promissory note given by one person to a political party. This party has to encash it within 15 days. This is the basic thing. Within 15 days, it has to encash that promissory note or electoral bond, where in that bond, the name of the giving person, the name of the person who is giving that will not be there. The name of the party will not be there. If the person generates an electoral bond scheme at an authorized bank, for example, let's take A is the person. He goes to a bank. Now SBI is authorized, so let's take SBI. Then he says, I want to have 4,000. I want to contribute 4,000 as an electoral funding. Then SBI gives this 4,000 bond, 4,000 worth electoral bond. This will be given to the political party. This political party, it opens an account with the bank. It gives that bond to the bank. Then this amount will be credited to that political party. This is the scheme of electoral bond. If we observe here, see, it's promissory note, it's interest free banking instrument. Who are eligible? This is also one of the important thing. All citizen of India or a body corporate incorporated in India, it means a company incorporated in India, can also purchase it. KYC norms are mandatory. By making payment from a bank account. Bank account is very necessary to go for electoral bond. Lifespan, within 15 days, this political party has to encash it. Though only those registered under Section 29A of Representation of People's Act is eligible to receive the funds under electoral bond scheme. Purchase period, etc. These are the details. For prelims, this is very, very important. We can expect one question from this area, either from the nature of the bond or lifespan and registration of the bond. From this perspective, I'm expecting one question out of this for the prelims. What are the benefits? This is for the mains examination. In the mains, non-disclosure, will the recipient won't disclose his name, the political party name won't be there on the bond. So because of this, the transparency in the political funding increases. Because the KYC norms are there and only from the bank account this amount is given. Because of this, political transparency or funding and transparency increases. This is for mains. Next topic. Next that was in news is environment protection and economic development must go together. This can be our question in our GS paper 3, where we study environment and conservation as a topic, or this can be asked as our essay, 125 marks. This can be asked for essay also. This statement was given by our vice president. So we need to think on this. We need to have this debate of environment and development must go together. If we have such statement, how we think of that? We say how first, why they should go together, that we should think on. After that, how they should go together, then we go for different strategies. In why, we say without going together, what happens, that we write. Likewise, we approach different questions. PIB is very important because it provides different speeches of eminent persons. If we can read this person's speech on this particular topic, we can have different dimensions to write in our mains examination, in both GS as well as in our essays. That's why whenever there are topics like this, please go through the original text of the speech. The next issue here is PM's interaction to Pragati. What is this Pragati? To know this, Pragati is a digital platform. This topic is under our GS paper 2 governance. Governance. In that, e-governance is the topic under which we study our e-governance applications like Pragati. Here, we should know what are the basic features of Pragati. Pragati, the abbreviation is proactive governance and timely implementation. From this abbreviation itself, we can say that implementation is there. So project implementation, proactive governance, in that redressal and monitoring comes. With the name itself, we can say what are its objectives. We have got the objectives. Now, what is Pragati? Pragati is nothing but a dashboard where at three levels, central ministries represented by secretaries, state ministries or state departments represented by secretaries at the state level, these two are coordinated through the PMO, Prime Minister's Office. PM chairs Pragati meeting, Prime Minister of India chairs Pragati meeting. In that, these three are interconnected: PMO, central ministries, state department secretaries. All these come together and they discuss regarding grievance redressal, project implementation and project monitoring. Why this is important? This was constituted after 2014. Why this is important means, earlier to this we have this term called policy paralysis, where there were implementation problems, stalled projects, the grievances were not addressed properly. Because of all these problems, to address all these problems, Pragati platform was devised. This is nothing but a dashboard wherein a PM can watch whatever monitoring or whatever implementation is happening, all that he can watch, and he can speak with central ministry secretaries, state department secretaries, and these two also can coordinate. This is the general structure of Pragati platform. Based on this central program, different states enacted their own platforms. For example, AP has CM Core dashboard. This is one of the very important things in our e-governance. It has won many awards. This is for AP, Andhra Pradesh. Pragati is on the similar model. Based on Pragati only, CM Core dashboard was implemented. This we need to know. For this, other than this, nothing much is important. Next topic is Exercise Harimau. Exercise Harimau is a joint training exercise between the forces of India and Malaysia. It was conducted in the Malaysia. Its major objective is to train both the forces in counter-insurgency operations. These two points we should remember, otherwise it's not that important. It is the first time such a huge scale military training, joint training is done between India and Malaysia. We have with other countries, we have it with USA, we have with UK. There are different names with different, this is with Navy, we have Operation Exercise Malabar. We have different names. We should know all these military exercises. Please make a note, separate note, where you write down that exercise name and between which countries. It's especially with India and which country? India, UK, India, Nepal, Surya Shakti, Surya Kiran, Desert Eagle, like that. There are many exercises. You try to note down exercise name, Navy, military, or which one is involved, and the country. These three you should make. You should make a small note of it for our prelims examination. Then, Human Resource Development Ministry launches Unnat Bharat Abhiyan. Unnat Bharat Abhiyan is a scheme that was there in the recent years. It's a very important scheme. We should identify this as part of our GS Paper 2 syllabus. In GS Paper 2, we have this concept of education. With that, we can identify this. We can identify this with rural development. With these two, we can identify the scheme. Let's see what are its features. Unnat Bharat Abhiyan, this is very important for our prelims. In prelims, what they can ask? They can ask, it is implemented by which ministry? It is implemented by Ministry of Human Resources and Development. The scheme is nothing but the colleges or some universities. They go to rural areas. They identify the needs of the people. They innovate. They come up with the solutions. That is the major theme of this thing. So, whenever we say this, some people might think it is by the Ministry of Science and Technology or by the Ministry of Rural Development. We may get confused between these, but this scheme is implemented by Ministry of Human Resources and Development. Under this, the objective is twofold. One is to improve the research facilities, the research capabilities of the institutions. Two is to find the solutions for the rural problems. These are the two. Earlier, when Unnat Bharat Abhiyan 1.0 was announced, it was only for the prominent institutions, prominent higher education institutions like IITs, IISCs, IIMs. But now, under Unnat Bharat Abhiyan 2.0, many higher educational institutions were added, and these are sent to identify the problems in different areas. In 1.0, Unnat Bharat Abhiyan 1.0, very few areas were given, 5 areas. But now many areas are given for the universities or colleges to explore and come up with the new solutions. This is the gist of the scheme. The next topic is Cabinet approves declaration of scheduled areas in respect of Rajasthan. In Rajasthan, in some mandals, some areas are identified as scheduled areas. We should know from which topic we need to connect this. This topic need to be connected with our GS paper 2, wherein we study about schedules. Schedules of the constitution. We have 12 schedules under our constitution, under which fifth schedule is for the scheduled areas. Scheduled areas other than 80 mm states, Assam, Tripura, Meghalaya and Mizoram. Other than these states, all other scheduled states which represents tribal population, they are included under the fifth schedule, under the article of 244. Now, we need to know for our prelims examination perspective, what are the provisions under our fifth schedule? Who has more authority? What are the special features that these areas get under our constitution? These things we should have. Fifth schedule areas, they have governor of the state. He or she has huge powers. He can restrict the act of parliament or state assembly to be enforced or to not to be enforced in that particular area for the welfare of the people in that particular place. Likewise, governor has a major role in the development and regulation of the scheduled areas. Other than that, we have Tribal Advisory Council, TAC, Tribal Advisory Council, to assist the governor in the planning and development of the fifth schedule areas. Please go to our Lakshmikant book or any polity book, read regarding the scheduled areas under the fifth schedule. Here, one important thing is, who notifies that particular area as fifth schedule area? Here we read cabinet. So when we have the question like, scheduled areas are notified by 1. Parliament, 2. President of India, 3. State government, 4. Or A, B, C, D, D, cabinet. If we can just read only this headline, we say that cabinet, but it is wrong. Who notifies a particular area as scheduled area is President of India. Cabinet suggests President of India to notify an area as scheduled area, but constitutionally under Article 244, President of India has the authority to notify particular area as scheduled area. There is no particular criteria mentioned to notify particular area as scheduled area. Only President of India notifies it. President of India can remove certain areas from the scheduled area list. These are the basic things we should know. Please go through any polity book and read about scheduled areas. Next, the next thing that is there in the news is Niti Aayog to open applications for Atal New India Challenge. We have New India Pledge. New India Pledge of 2022. This January 26th, 2018, we have this New India Pledge of 2022. For that, to have a New India, Niti Aayog went for this Atal New India Challenge. It sought for applications from different people. Under this, innovators, either individual innovator or startup or any MSME, they can come up with the innovative idea and win this context by giving the market relevant and the emerging innovations. Here we should know Atal Innovation Mission. Atal Innovation Mission is implemented by which authority? That can be the question. Minister of Science and Technology, PMO, something. The answer is Niti Aayog. Under Niti Aayog, Atal Innovation Mission, as a mission mode project is developed. Under this mission only, Atal Innovation Challenge, Atal Innovation India Challenge, it was given. Five ministries in collaboration started this challenge. The winner will be given 5 crore rupees grant to develop on that particular idea. 17 areas are mentioned. 1 crore grant is given to the innovator, either individual innovator, startup or MSME. For them, 1 crore as a grant will be given under this challenge. Prelims question they can ask from this Atal New India Challenge is regarding what? It is implemented by what? Such kind of factual question they may ask from this area. Next, NDMA conducts mock exercises in the Northeast on earthquake. Here, this can be asked as a prelims question, mains question with respect to our GS Paper 3 Disaster Management. Under Disaster Management, we have this authority called National Disaster Management Authority. We read different disasters associated guidelines by the NDMA. In this particular issue, on that date, on Northeast, earthquake drill, mock drill was conducted. Now let's see, what is NDMA and what are its functions? NDMA is National Disaster Management Authority. It is devised under NDMA Act of 2005. Under which it is the central coordinating authority of all central ministries, state governments in planning and coordinating the disaster management plans. This is in brief what is NDMA. R is earthquake zones. Earthquake zones of India. Here, Northeast, why they have conducted mock drills in Northeast is, Northeast is in zone 5. Highly prone to earthquakes. If we observe this map, this is earthquake vulnerability map of India. Who publishes this? Bureau of Indian Standards under the Ministry of Earth Sciences. Ministry of Earth Sciences, it publishes the vulnerability maps. If we observe here, this area, entire Northeast is under zone 5. We have 4 zones, zone 2, zone 3, zone 4 and zone 5. Zone 5 is high risk area because of the active plate tectonics of the Himalayas. This area is highly prone to earthquakes. Because of that, it's vulnerable. That's why mock drills were conducted in that particular area. This is what we need to remember. Once go through this map, vulnerability map for the earthquakes, you can see which areas are under 2, vulnerability zone 2, which areas under vulnerable zone 3, which areas are under 4, which areas are under 5. You just need to know 5 will be sufficient for the major cities. You just go through if there are under zone 4 or not. This will be sufficient. The next issue is Dhan Scheme. Dhan Scheme was launched by our Prime Minister to increase tribal income. This was in the news. What is this scheme? Before this, this comes under which topic? We can include it as a topic under GS Paper 1. In GS Paper 1, social empowerment we read, wherein we read regarding tribal issues and associated problems. Then we can write to uplift them socio-economically. This scheme was launched. See, remember one thing. The current affairs is used as a clues or examples to support our arguments in our mains examination. This particular scheme can be used here. Or This can be used in our GS paper too, welfare schemes for the vulnerable sections. Vulnerable sections, in that also we can use this. But this scheme is very important for our prelims point of view. Vandhan Vikas Kendras. Vandhan Vikas Kendras are established. Before that, we should know what is the objective of this scheme. Vandhan scheme is nothing but tribals who are dependent on forest produce, especially the minor forest produce. They collect minor forest produce. As of now, they are selling it to the institution called TriFed. TriFed is PSU, Public Sector Undertaking under Ministry of Tribal Affairs. This TriFed procures the forest produce from the tribals and it sells it through the outlets. This was the process earlier. Now the government want to value add in this here. Value addition here means, for example, if they are collecting some leaves, you process them and sell it to the TriFed, then they can sell it to the market outlets. This was the objective of establishing Vandhan scheme. Under this, Vandhan Vikas Kendras, they act as processing units. Here, training will be given, basic equipment will be provided for the tribals to go for the processing of minor forest produce. Then they sell it to the TriFed. This TriFed, under PPP, public-private partnership model, it can send it to the secondary processor, a big MNC or some other food processor. For them, it can sell and get the remunerative price for the tribals. Getting socio-economic empowerment through sustainable livelihood is the objective of Vandhan scheme. That we need to remember here. TriFed as an institution, we should remember from police perspective. Vandhan Vikas Kendras, we should remember. Training, etc., PPP model. These three points we should remember from the prelims perspective. In mains, we can use this as an example in our answers. The last topic of this video is regarding Adopt a Village scheme. This is studied under our GS2, the development and related issues. Under this can be studied, or in our GS paper 3 we study about service sector, wherein we study specifically about the tourism. For that we should know schemes like this. Adopt a heritage scheme is nothing but there are huge diverse monuments in India. So government, what it does is it goes for a bid called vision bid. It's not the financial bid, vision bid. Vision bid means the idea given by the bidder. For example, Charminar, it's one monument. If the bidder comes with an excellent idea wherein that monument can be protected, then that monument will be adopted by that particular organization or the bidder. Here, CSR funds, corporate social responsibility funds of different organizations are used for this purpose. There was a criticism saying that our national monuments are given to the corporates. But the clarification here is the core activities like the architecture renovation, etc., are not given to the corporates. Only building the public conveniences or some facilities like sanitation, etc., only those areas are given to these bidders or outsources. Otherwise, the core areas like the architectural renovations are not given to these bidders. What we should remember here is it is a collaboration of Ministry of Tourism, Ministry of Culture and Archaeological Survey of India. They collaborate with the private sector, wherein they use their CSR funds for the development of these monuments. Here, Adopt a Heritage is essentially based on non-revenue generating product. It's not a revenue generating product. It's based on the CSR. Then Monument Mitras, these organizations or institutions or persons who adopt these monuments, they are called Monument Mitras. Vision Bid, very important here. Vision Bid is nothing but what is their idea, ideology or vision for that monument. It is considered and accordingly the monument is given for bidding under this particular scheme. These are the points that are important from our prelims perspective. They can ask which ministry implements it, or they may ask this point or monument mitra, any of these points from the prelims perspective. In the last slides, I have given two questions to answer from the prelims perspective. Please answer in the comment section. Thank you very much. Hope this video is very useful for you. Thank you.